Fargo, Georgia. Not much going on 441 this morning. Got a place down there with trucks to refuel just before hitting Florida. We're going out to get breakfast now before we hit the road for the day. We're here at the Gator Motel near the Okefenokee Swamp. We're going to go over and eat breakfast at the Suwanee River Café, which opens at 5:30 in the morning. I think it's about 6 now. And the main store, this is it. This is the main store in Fargo, and we're standing on Highway 441, which actually goes all the way to Cherokee, North Carolina, that we'll be at later on this trip. And here we have rush hour on Highway 441, right in the middle of Fargo. Mainly some large tractor trailers go through every now and then. Got a refueling station. A lot of logging trucks, no surprise there. There's the cafe, my wife, wave. All right. Yep, this is rush hour. I've been thinking the camera is out of focus the whole time. It's my eyes that are out of focus. I can't see the little screen. Gotta give me some reading glasses that I attach to the camera or something. Well, ready to roll. Let's see what happens. Well, we're off today to the University of Florida. Bat houses. We have about an hour and a half ride ahead of us here. Thought I would try my hand at actual live blogging while we're rolling. Now today, we're riding our Ural motorcycles to Florida. We're leaving Fargo, Georgia. Here's where we ate breakfast this morning at the Suwanee River Cafe. It's a good breakfast. Enjoyed it. Nice tractor for sale. Yeah, I'm riding my 2008 Tourist. My wife's on a 2010 Patrol Ural. And it's about 7:20 this morning. We got up a little early, got ready, got packed. Heading on down the road. It's like 441 breaks off to the right. The main industry here is logging.
Well, that's enough of that. That was just taking way too long to sit there and try to edit that audio and clean it up. It was a lot noisier than I expected it to be.
So in this video, I'm just going to do a little bit of the FAQ about the trip, talk about the details, why we did it, why this is unusual for us, and answer a few questions that we've been getting since we got back from the trip. And right now we're on Highway 441. We have either just entered Florida or are about to enter Florida out of Georgia after leaving Fargo. Now we encountered some deer you'll see coming up here. Kind of hard to make out in the video, but that's actually a small deer running across the roadway. And what you can't really see is there's deer on both sides, and you would have heard me blowing the horn here to kind of give those deer a heads up that we're on our way. Never want to hit deer while you're traveling. That's never a good event. So the first question might be, why are you taking this trip? And paired with that, why is it such a big deal? Well, we're taking this trip because it's our 25th wedding anniversary, and we wanted to get away and take a vacation and do something that for us is a little bit unconventional. Now, as to why this trip is such a big deal, is my wife, this is her first year riding a motorcycle, and I have not ridden basically in 27 years, I think it was, rode when I was young and just decided to come back with a rig. There's other videos about that, but what the real deal is the length of this trip was right at 25 days, and we're on the road. But what makes it so unusual, especially for us, is there's very little plan going into this. It's not that we didn't plan our route. We did plan to stay in the southeast so that we're never a long way from home. We can call and have a truck to us within a day or two at most to come haul us back home if we needed it. But the real issue was is that we did not plan this trip out to the extent of knowing where we would be each day. We knew that we wanted to go to Fargo the first day. We knew that we were going into Hollapaw to get a clutch in my wife's patrol. We knew that we kind of wanted to go down over toward the west coast of Florida, mainly to get down to the Everglades and go down highway, I think it's Highway 41 down there. We knew all of this going in, but remember as you're watching our trip videos, we don't know where our hotel is. We don't know where we will be staying any more than maybe a day out as to where we will be staying. Some mornings we don't even know where we're going that day. We simply get up and we know that we're going to be headed in a certain direction in a certain way. And we make our reservation usually for a hotel, sometimes just walk in. We did learn to use our apps to get a better deal rather than just walking in and a walk-in rate, but we made reservations at a few of the hotels we stayed at in the parking lot. We pulled up and said, yeah, this looks like a good place, and we would find a good deal using our cell phone app, and we'd make a reservation and immediately walk in and book the room. And in some instances we saved anywhere from 10 to, I think the most extreme saving we got was about $30 off the room rate by booking it with the app rather than walking in. And we learned fairly quickly with the Airbnb that it was best to go ahead and book it a day ahead of time. So, for example, when we booked Naples, where we stayed in this trip, we booked it a day ahead of time by searching on Airbnb. We had decided that we wanted to go to Naples, and we let the Airbnb search kind of determine where we were going. Now, maybe for you that's not a big deal, but for my wife and I, that is a big deal to set out on the road with no really clear plan of where we're going to be day to day, where the hotel reservations are going to be, or where we're going to be staying, or who we're going to be staying with. This was about kind of experiencing a kind of freedom that is unique to us anyway to experience, because we've always been extensive planners in our trips. So part of this trip was to experience that in a more intense form, more than a 2 or 3 days of not having a plan. We set off basically for a month on 2 motorcycles with everything that we thought we needed packed in them, with virtually no clear plan other than we wanted to make it to Key West, we wanted to get a clutch in the patrol, and we wanted to drive the full length of the Blue Ridge Parkway. That was it. Nothing else was planned ahead of time. And that was a challenge. I didn't fret with it as much as my wife did, but I will admit that for both of us, this trip was a challenge on that level. And all that said, I will admit that we enjoyed this trip, even exceeding our own expectations. We really did not expect to enjoy it to the level that we did. We figured that we would enjoy it, don't get me wrong, we didn't take off on this trip thinking, well, we're about to have a miserable time. We knew that we were going to enjoy the trip, but neither of us anticipated just how much we were going to enjoy the trip, and especially the freedom of it, of not being locked into any kind of plan and being able to just go where we wanted to go when we took the notion to go there. The next question that I've had repeatedly is, what did we do to the rigs to prepare for the trip? And I learned quickly that they're not asking what did we put on the rigs, what accessories did we attach. You can see that in our other videos. What I discovered they were asking is, how did you take two Urals and ride 3,400 miles on them and not be paranoid the entire time, not be concerned about breakdowns? How did you nurse two Urals through a 3,400 mile trip in 1 month and not have a single serious breakdown or problem? And I guess in a way I understand the question. With all of the bad press that Ural gets on some of the forums about how unreliable they are, I get it. But the truth is, this is the truth. We didn't do anything special to prepare the rigs for the trip other than maintain them. I did go through, I made sure all of the oils were changed, I checked all the gaps, I set the valve lash, I did all of the normal standard things that should be done, and I looked for loose bolts, loose connections, anything like that that might be of concern, and took care of it before we left on the trip. We did take all of our spares with us. We took our tools with us. And you will see in this trip, we had to use a few tools on this trip. This was not a 100% trouble-free trip. We did have a few issues. I'll save that for you so that you can watch them in future videos. So if you haven't subscribed yet, go ahead and subscribe. But we had no major mechanical issues. The engine didn't fall out. The bike didn't blow up. Nothing major came off of it. We didn't lose any wheels, no bearings seized up. And I'm amazed at how many times I have been asked that question with that intent. I try to start answering the question with, well, I had the biker's friend put on for a backrest, and they're like, no. I mean, what did you do? Put magic snake oil in it or something to keep the engine from blowing up? Seriously, if that's your opinion of Ural from, I'm going to say, 2006 model forward, you really need to take another look at the bikes and talk to the actual owners who have ridden them and understand that these are not buckets of bolts just looking for a place to fall apart. These are fairly reliable motorcycles, and properly maintained can go for thousands of miles. There's a 2011 I'm aware of with, I guess, 80,000 plus kilometers on it. My wife's patrol that you see right now is coming up on 50,000 kilometers after this trip. We're still riding it. The tourist that I'm on is approaching 30,000 kilometers. We've not had any major issues or problems with them. Now, coming up in this trip, again, subscribe, you will see why we were taking the patrol to Halepaw Ural to get a new clutch installed. And you will see that we did do a few other things while we were there. Again, I'll save that for you so that you've got something to watch in the future videos. But these bikes made it just fine, 3,400 miles, and they did fantastic. From sea level, literally sea level on the beach in Daytona, to however high Mount Mitchell is up in North Carolina, 6,500 feet, somewhere around there, they did fine. And, I have no complaints on them. They have been reliable for us, and I know a lot of owners that also have rigs that have been reliable for them. Okay, I'm not working from a script here. I do have a lot of questions written down over here that I'm reading from. I've never been accused of working from a script or sounding like I am. But the next question that I have over here is about packing the rigs. And how are the rigs packed. Well, we have a future video coming up that will kind of show packing the rigs, and I won't go into too much detail here. But I will say that we divided the purpose of the rigs when we packed them. My rig is packed for hotel camping, and my wife's rig is packed for camping. And what I mean by that is everything that is in my rig is what we would need to take in if we stop at a hotel. We do not have to open up the cover on the patrol or take anything out of it if we're staying in a hotel. Everything in the patrol has to do with camping. So when we stop somewhere, if we're stopping at a campground, then we unload both rigs. But if we're stopping at a hotel, then we only have to unload my rig to go in and actually camp. And we divided it up that way on purpose. We didn't have any issues doing that. There were a couple of things in her rig that we would pull out for the hotel, but they were packed in the trunk. We didn't have to open the tonneau cover or anything to do that. Now, you're looking at a beautiful stretch of road here. I hope you're enjoying the video. This is Highway 441 coming into Florida. We go through a small town every now and then. One of the straightaways was somewhere around 10 miles long, and it's just gorgeous to sit back, ride down the road, and cruise. And if you're on anything other than in a car or a truck out on the interstate just trying to make time, I would encourage you to break away from Interstate I-75 if you're headed up north. Break away from I-75. I think it was Lakeland, Florida. Take Highway 441. Cruise through the rural part of North Florida and into South Georgia and up through Georgia. And you'll eventually, if you just stay on 441, you'll cross over Interstate 85, I-85. And if you still stay on 441, you'll make an interesting route, but you'll end up actually in Cherokee, North Carolina. But beautiful, beautiful road to cruise down on a motorcycle. It's phenomenal. And in this video, I'm aware that I'm wearing a helmet cam, so I'm trying not to just spin my head around, but I'm turning my eyes and trying to keep my head movement as subdued as possible. I'm still looking around, but I didn't want to give you guys this weird view of everything all over the place. But it's beautiful, beautiful country up there. We've been there a couple of times now. We actually went back recently down to Fargo. We've driven this route twice now, and it's phenomenal. If you have the time, hit Highway 441 in North Florida and cruise up through Georgia and just enjoy the scenery and stop in Fargo, Georgia. It's one of the few places I've seen the post office and the corner gas station in the same building, but it's just a beautiful little town. And, you know, have lunch at the cafe there, the Suwanee River Café. But we're cruising on down the road now, and we're headed toward the University of Florida in Gainesville to see their bat houses. For those of you that don't know, my wife and I, we operate Habitat for Bats, and we produce a commercial grade bat house. We produce bat house kits, and we also do bat house educational workshops where we help kids build. So that's Habitat for Bats, and I'll put a link up here somewhere. I think I can here. And you can check out Habitat for Bats if you're interested. But that's why we're going to the bat houses at the University of Florida, is to see them and do some short videos there that'll get published on our Habitat for Bats YouTube channel. So I'll finish this video out answering a few questions here. We've had a few people ask, if I were planning to take a long trip on a Ural, what would you suggest? Is there any advice that you can give us? Well, certainly, I can give you some advice. You can take it for what it's worth. My first question would be to you, are you insane? Insanity should not be underrated if you want to take a trip like this. Insanity can be very valuable to you. So that's my first question, is to just ask yourself, are you insane? And if you still want to take this trip, then proceed. Second piece of advice is get a comfortable seat. The tractor seats that come standard on the Urals I don't know what it is about them. The metal frame, the way that it engages to my rear end, is not comfortable. It's not even close to comfortable. So make sure you can ride that seat for 200 to 300 miles and that you can sit in it for 6 to 8 hours a day, because that's what is going to be required. Now, I have a Harley solo seat that I put on mine. It's great. There's a video about it. You can check it out. But this is not a short trip. Make sure you have a comfortable seat. I also put the Air Hawk on mine. I won't say that I love the Air Hawk. I will just say that I respect the Air Hawk. It does help. It's not a cure-all. You don't put it on, sit on it, and go, wow, this is great. But it does help you hang into the saddle for longer periods of time. The third thing I would tell you is make sure you have the right tires on your rig. Now, we're running the Heidenau K28s. They're nice. They feel just excellent on pavement. They're good tires for pavement traveling. And for long trips like this, I highly recommend them. They've been wearing well. We're getting well over 4,000. I think right now we've got over 5,000 on one of the pushers, and it's still got a little tread. They hold up well, and they change the handling characteristics of the rig a little bit to the better on pavement. But when we got out on the beach, not so much. These are not off-road tires, so be aware of that. But if you're taking a long trip like this, make sure you have good tires that perform well for what you need them to do. The fourth thing I would suggest is make absolutely sure your rig is aligned properly. If it is not aligned properly, you will be miserable at some point fighting this thing. You will fight the handlebars down the road. I rode this thing after I first got it, maybe a 300-mile trip, and I couldn't feel my shoulders when I got where I was going. It was so bad. And that's when I learned all I could about aligning the rigs. Now, just to let you know, we run about a 3/8 inch toe in. This is a starting point for you. Don't be afraid to change the alignment a little bit if it's not performing for you, because there's weight differences, the center of gravity. There's just so many things that can be kind of tweaked with a little bit of a change in alignment. So don't everybody run out and align your rigs to this specification. This is what works for us. We give it about 3/8 inch of toe in, which is what the factory recommends, but we found that we like 2.5 to 3 degrees of outward lean on the bike. That seems to work best and neutralize the pull, make the rig track straight, and it really helps the handling characteristics. And that's with the Heidenau's K28s that are on it, which have a flat profile. And you can definitely see the wear pattern on the Heidenau tires, the K28s, from that lean. You can look at it and very quickly tell we've got a pretty good bit of outward lean on the rigs. But we like it, and it makes the rigs handle well, and we adjusted the alignment during this trip. When I started this trip, my Tourist had 1.5 degree of outward lean, and by the time we got back, I had adjusted it twice to 2.5 degrees. And it works much, much better for me. Right where it's at right now is great. The patrol also right around that 2.5 degree mark. I say 2.5 to 3 degrees because, I'm on a concrete floor and measuring, and so it's between 2.5 and 3 degrees outward lean. And how I got to that was not by measuring. I simply loosened the bolt and gave the turnbuckle one full turn and put it back together and rode it. And if it felt better, now I made sure I rode it at least 100 miles. If it felt better, I left it. If it didn't, I pulled it out and I gave it another full turn. And lo and behold, we crept up on that 2.5 to 3 degree lean. Fifth would be ride. Don't think that riding, an hour here, an hour there is going to do it. Ride an hour, ride an hour and a half, ride 2 hours. Just keep riding to prepare for the trip and work yourself up to that 300 to 350 mile day. Be prepared. Make sure all your maintenance is done. Make sure that everything is right on the bike. pay attention to the bike. If it doesn't sound right, if it doesn't feel right, if it doesn't smell right, stop. Figure it out before you keep going. Because a big problem can be avoided if you catch it when it's a little problem. Otherwise, you might be walking. Choose your upgrades wisely. Take a series of short trips building up. Choose the upgrades that are most useful, most effective for you on the rig, and only add those. And then lastly, I would say, take some extra fuel. You'll see our Rotopax cans on there. We use those a few times. Very useful to take extra fuel with you. Well, I hope you've enjoyed the video. Again, I hate to just sit here and ramble, but you know, this is one of the FAQ videos. Some of our upcoming videos will be a little different. But if you haven't subscribed yet, please do. Hit the subscribe button. We enjoy having subscribers come in. Post questions. Ask your questions. Let us know what you're thinking. Let us know your questions, what you might want to see us do in the future. Just talk to us a little bit about that. And really important, hit that like button. The like button is really important for our videos. It changes the metric on YouTube so that we show up in the suggested list more often and we get more traffic to our channel. So be sure to hit that like button too. We appreciate you watching and you have a good day.